So, yeah, it's working. So I think we should get started now. My accent is American. Yeah. We have a lot of people here, different countries, different continents. And it's my pleasure to open the Symmetry Festival for the International Symmetry Association. And I want to thank all of the people who were involved in putting this together. It's been a tremendous task. Bertolotti Center and so on. There are many people, and I don't want to take too much time. I just make some brief introductions now. Gyuri Darvas from Budapest has spent an enormous amount of effort getting things in shape, and I want to give him a particular thanks. Gyuri, thank you. So the way I'd like to proceed is, first I will introduce the members of the board. I'll introduce myself. My name is Larry Gould. I'm the chairman of the executive board of the ISA. And then I'd like to introduce Christoph Finivesi, he will say some brief words, and then I will introduce Renata Kreitberger, she will introduce Peter Weibel, who's going to give a talk from a distant location. Okay, Christoph is the CEO of the ISA. So, Christoph, please.
Thank you very much, Larry. Good morning for everybody. It's a warm greetings in Vienna, in the Technical University of Vienna. It's my great pleasure to greet you here. Sorry about my Hungarian or Finnish accent, if you want. And just as Larry told us, Gyuri Darvas made a tremendous amount of work to bring us together this year in this beautiful city of Vienna after the beautiful city of Delft. And based on the great success of the Delft conference, and we can have the greatest and the best expectations about this Vienna meeting. So I'm really thrilled about to work with you, to think together with you, to wonder about the beauty of symmetries with you in these Sundays with all these distinguished speakers and workshop leaders who came together here. And it's also my pleasure to say thank you for the Technical University of Vienna, especially to Professor Wolfgang Hofkirchner, who couldn't be here today because he's very busy with many conferences, but he will join us in some days, after some days in the meeting. And I also would like to say thank you to Robert Jahn from the Bertalanffy Center of System Studies, who also made great work to bring all of this together, and also the Balassi Institute, which offered us space for the Symmetry Festivals, exhibitions, and music program as well. And it's also my great pleasure to say thank to Renata Kreitberger, without whom we couldn't be here today. She took care about all the local organizing and brought together this wonderful network which took care about us. So I wish you all to a very fruitful meeting and enjoy Vienna, this wonderful city. Thank you very much, Gyuri. Thank you very much, Renate.
Just one other person on the board, Sergei Petukhov. Please just stand up and So I will now pass the microphone over to Renata, and she will say some words about Vienna and also introduce Peter Weibel.
Thank you. Thank you for letting me be part of the Symmetry family, and it's a great pleasure and honor for me to organize the things around take place in Vienna. It's just a few words that I want to thank you what you said before, the Bertha Landwehr Center, and Werner will be here and will do some streamings, and I was preparing some slides, but it's not important. I just want to say thank you to, that we have support. Thanks for the support of the city of Vienna, and especially for the talk of Rachel Avani, which is in cooperation with the Wiener Vorlesungen, and also thank you. I have the honor that I could make the first logo, which was symbolizing the the five-dimensional space, but we know Einstein had some troubles with it, and that's why it's not on the bags. But I'm really happy that you give me all this support to promote my findings also in the Symmetry editions. And I want to introduce now. So this was Einstein 1921 in Vienna, but maybe it's not good that we show all the slides. We can go quickly, and I just wanted to say thank you to Wolfgang Hofkirchner, but Christoph did already. And and there's just one. And Wiener Vorlesungen, which supported by Christian Ehart from the Stadt Wien, the Science Department. And I welcome to all the planetary speakers, and thanks to ORF, who was already announcing the Symmetry concerts, and to our special guests from Japan and Styria, Ben Skepa, and all these great things that will come with the Family Day, and welcome in Vienna, the city of the relativity. And now I have the honor to introduce you to the plenary speaker, Peter Weibel. I had the honor to have the Quantum Cinema Project with him, and now he's going to open the ceremony.
privilege and pleasure to be with you and to welcome you, even if only virtually. I feel deeply honored and accept with great gratitude the position of a patron of the world's largest multidisciplinary conference and art festival in symmetry studies 2016 in Vienna. I wish I could be with you physically and listen to all the outstanding, excellent lectures by world-renowned keynote and plenary speakers who will inform us about their groundbreaking, innovative ideas and lead us to the frontiers of their research fields in the true tradition of enlightenment. That is, science unites people and minds. Science will unite us in the following days, and the principle that unites science and disciplines is symmetry. In art and architecture, symmetry was and still is one of the most striking, productive, fundamental essential principles. From the architect Juan de Herrera of 16th century, who wrote the book Discurso sobre la figura cúbica, about the cubic form, and who built the Palace El Escorial in Madrid for King Philip II, to Victor Vasarely, the central figure of op art in the 20th century. We realize the dominance of symmetry about 400-500 years. But symmetry is more than the beauty of proportion. Symmetry and asymmetry have become basic principles in the natural sciences. Symmetry has become a universal principle, from anthropology to cosmology. Symmetry is an epistemological tool. Symmetry is not only an ontological mirror reflecting on what there is. Symmetry teaches us what we know about what there is. And therefore, symmetry is an epistemological tool. As a universal principle, it can serve us on the road to knowledge and wisdom in chemistry and physics and anthropology and geometry and music and even in psychiatry. The Chilean psychanalyst Ignacio Mate Blanco, who died in 1995, explores the nature of the unconscious in his book of 1975, The Unconscious as Infinite Sets, with two principles, the principle of generalization and the principle of symmetry. And he said, the unconscious can treat the converse of any relations as identical to it. That is, it deals with relationships as symmetrical. For Mate Blanco, unconscious is marked by what he called symmetry. There is a preferring of sameness and concomitant and implicit aversion to difference, while the quality of ego functioning is the registering and bearing of difference, which he called asymmetry. In physics, symmetry, as you know, is defined as the characteristics of a system to remain invariant after transformations. The symmetry of the linear Maxwell equations play a central role because the invariance of the Maxwell equations after the Lorentz transformations have been one of the starting points for Einstein's theory of relativity. And the observed symmetry breaking made the existence of Higgs boson particles necessary. Electromagnetic waves have been derived from the linear Maxwell equations. Therefore, we ask, what is the future of gravitational waves? Symmetry principles act in different systems and disciplines. The historian of science, Bruno Latour, develops a project he calls symmetrical anthropology. From the chemical universe to the physical universe, all is characterized as a morphological principle of symmetry, from fullerene structure to medical drugs, from the anatomy of man, which is characterized by vertical symmetry, to helical viral structures and to galaxies and other dynamical systems of self-organization, from macro to microcosmos, we encounter the symmetry principle, very well formulated by the Spanish Catalan philosopher Raimundus Lullo in 13th century. He says, "The world is an image of God. Man is an image of the world. This is a perfect symmetrical conception. Symmetry studies are therefore not the next evolution. Symmetry studies are an ongoing, lasting revolution. You will experience it in the next days, and you will experience it in 2019, when the Symmetry Festival will take place in my center, the Center for Art and Media in Karlsruhe. And therefore, I welcome you to the future."
Thank you very much. I love being a part of the ISA because, as was just indicated, symmetry has such widespread application. This conference is going to have highly multidisciplinary talks and over physics and chemistry and biology and music and wonderful performances, and I hope you enjoy the entire week. Now I'd like to introduce Professor Peter Eichelberg. He is a professor of physics at the University of Vienna. And I'm supposed to keep this introduction short, so I shall. He's a full professor there, and he has written many papers, given many talks in Europe and overseas, and he is also the chairman of the advisory scientific committee, if I've got this right, of the Alpbach, Forum on Alpbach. Alpbach, yeah. My German hasn't quite come up to it yet. I still have some things to go. You just heard that there's symmetry that takes place in relativity, and quite importantly so. And the next speaker is Professor Eichelberg, and the title of his lecture is Symmetry Principles in Einstein's Theory of Relativity.
Good morning, everybody. Can you hear me? In the last row, can you hear me? Yes, good, thank you. So let me start by thanking the organizers for inviting me. I'm very honored to give here the first lecture, and thank you for your kind introduction. A small correction, I was the chairman of the Scientific Advisory Board for 15 years, so I gave up now. And being that chairman, I know how difficult it is to organize a conference like this, because I was involved for many years in putting together at least part of the European Forum, Alpbach. This is a very mixed audience, I guess, I try to be as simple as possible, or to put it in Einstein's word, to be as simple as possible, but not simpler. The subtitle of this conference is 100 Years of Relativity, and as I understand, there are several talks on relativity, especially a talk on gravitational waves. In this first talk, I'm going to be very elementary, try to convey to you what are the basic ideas that Einstein led to the formulation of his theory of gravity. And on this basis, on this very basis, are symmetry principles. And I, of course, these are mathematical things, but I will be trying to, in words, to describe to you what are the main concepts and what are the consequences of this. So the picture you see here is a numerical simulation from compact objects that radiate gravitational waves, as is the outcome of the theory of Einstein. Einstein's relativity. These are very tedious, you will hear this in the work of Professor Wilke, but a very tedious numerical calculations, which are essential for identifying the observed data. So let me turn now to my subjects. I start very simply. Yeah, I can use this, thank you. By introducing Newton's absolute space and time. These are two quotations from Newton himself. Absolute true and mathematical space remains similar and immovable. Maybe I go here and read it from here, but you can read it. And this, without any relation to anything external, analogous to mathematical time, which is also when its relation passes equally without relation to anything external. Now, Newton was quite aware this is a theoretical construction. He himself says that this, for example, absolute time cannot be measured actually by any device, by any clock. So he was very critical. He was also heavily criticized by Kant and later by Mach, and I will say a little words about this later. But this Newtonian space, as postulated by Newton, has symmetries. He assumed that this space has symmetries, and here I listed the symmetries. Absolute space is homogeneous and isotropic. What does this mean? It means homogeneous means that all points in space are equivalent. In equivalent in the sense that the laws of nature are the same in every point of space. Isotropic means that all directions are equivalent, which means that that wherever you look out in all directions, every direction is equally, which implies a so-called rotational symmetry. I haven't said translational symmetries means that from the points are translated, all the points are translated by an equal amount. And then there is also this about the time. Time is homogeneous, and this implies that the laws of nature have to be time translational symmetry. So what does this mean? It was Emmy Noether, a German mathematician, who worked with David Hilbert in Göttingen on problems of relational problems and the consequences of being invariant under certain transformations. And in this paper of Emmy Noether, there are two essential theorems, namely the one on global symmetries and the one on local symmetries. Global symmetries are the ones which I just mentioned. You have a constant translation, let's say, in space for all the points. Yeah? Whereas local symmetries, play a different role. Local means that the transformations change from point to point. And both of these theorems are essential in Einstein theory. But please notice that this paper was in 1918, so 3 years after Einstein finished his theory. Would have he known this before, it would have saved him maybe 2 to 3 years of work. So there you see the importance of these papers. And nowadays, these Noether theorems are fundamental for modern physics, especially for modern particle physics, where the concept of so-called gauge theories, which are local symmetries, are important. Now, when Noether died, Einstein wrote an article in the New York Times and said, Fräulein Noether was the most significant creative mathematician thus far produced since the higher education of women began. It's an interesting remark. Well, what does it mean? Where's the importance of this? Well, the importance is that symmetries, or global symmetry that I've just said, are essential, well, from Fuller conservation laws. I just realized that I'm standing here and you wouldn't get any good pictures. Is that okay? Okay. It's okay. No. Yeah, it's okay. It's okay. Thank you. Okay, so global symmetries imply conservation laws. And conservation laws are eminently important for understanding of physical systems. And not only physical systems, all systems essentially. So time translation, homogeneity of time, as I've said, implies the energy conservation of the system. Space translation implies that the momentum, that the total energy, total momentum of the system is conserved during the development. And finally, the rotations. Rotational symmetries imply that the total angular momentum of a system is conserved in time. But there's an additional symmetry in Newtonian theories, which was already known to Galilei, which I call Galilean symmetry. It has to do with the motion, relative motion to system to each other. And Galileo was aware that all systems which move uniformly, so in straight line with constant velocity, are equivalent. Equivalent in the sense, physical equivalent, that whenever you perform an experiment in that system, without looking outside, you cannot find out whether it's moving or not. You cannot find out if it's moving or not. So velocity is relative, and so here's a little picture saying there's a boat with constant velocity traveling on the sea, and there's a gentleman letting a little ball, let it fall, and when the ball falls, the ship is moving during the fall time, the ship is moving to the left. And the question is, where does the ball hit the bottom of the boat, the ship? And knowing the relativity principle, it's clear. Knowing the symmetry, the Galilean symmetry, it's clear where it will be, just as if the boat would be at rest in the water. So you see there are manifest sort of consequences about this symmetry. Now, but there came up a problem, which is the so-called eta problem, when James Maxwell put forward the equations for the electromagnetic field, as Peter Weibel said about the symmetry of Maxwell's equations he mentioned. So here comes the problem that it was assumed that there exists a kind of medium called eta, which is everywhere, penetrates everything, it's everywhere in space. And the electromagnetic waves excite this ether, and then up, then this excitation of the ether propagate from one source to the absorber, let's say. But this, of course, singles out a rest system, namely the system where the ether is at rest. And when you move against the ether, you will see a difference. You will see this was the idea. This contradicts the Galilean symmetry. This would contradict the and the solution came from Einstein. As I said, Galileo, Newton, and then there was Maxwell, and there was a contradiction. There was a contradiction, Newtonian Galilean symmetry, there was a contradiction, but Einstein solved it by putting forward the theory that is now known by the name special relativity. So Einstein in 1905 says that the relativity principle, namely the Galilean relativity, the relativity principle that all bodies in that move with constant, straight line constant velocity, so uniform motion, is universal. It also applies for electromagnetism, also applies for the electromagnetic waves. And therefore I said there is no ether. There is no medium that electromagnetic field doesn't need a medium that in which it propagates. And this is, of course, a very, very strong idea, with dramatic consequences. With dramatic consequences for physics. And the new and out of this, of course, the Galilean symmetry doesn't work. But a new symmetry, which was also mentioned by Peter Weigel, Lorentz, and Poincaré, with the new thing about this is that it does away with absolute time. These symmetries mix space and time. And here is Hermann Minkowski in a conference in 1904 made this rather strong statement that space and time become something like space time, where it says completely to become mere shadows. Space and time become mere shadows. Only a type of union of two will still stand. And the union is here, so to, oops, the union is here. I will not go into detail. The space intervals and time intervals are observer dependent. There is something like space time intervals which are invariant, which are, this is the new symmetry, and among those, especially, is the velocity of light. The velocity of light is constant in every system that moves uniformly, as we have stated. So, this was the thing. But then Einstein asked himself, but what is so special about a uniform motion? Why not every motion? So velocity is relative, but acceleration is absolute. Why is acceleration absolute? Well, because we feel inertia. We feel the resistance against the change of velocity. Everybody of us experienced this, traveling in a train, traveling in a car, whenever you are braking, probably feel this. Why is this? Why this asymmetry? What is so special about the constant velocity? And already in 1907, he said, is it conceivable that the principle of relativity is also valid for systems that are accelerated to each other. In a seminar in 1913 in Vienna, Einstein was already quite certain that the principle of relativity should be generalized to arbitrary systems, to arbitrary moving systems. And he says, it does not make sense to speak about motion, including acceleration of a body itself. It is only possible to speak about motion or acceleration of a body with respect to other bodies. You see, so there's a symmetry between the things. So, and this was his guiding principle for formulating theory of gravity. In 1916, so in 1915, at the end of it, he published his paper on relativity, but then he says in a paper like the Foundation of General Relativity, the laws of physics must be such nature that they apply to systems of reference in any kind of motion. And one could summarize this general principle of relativity that only relative motion matters, so only one can say that one is in motion relative to something, not relative to absolute space. But then is the question of inertia. Is like, why then is there inertia? Or there are no singled out reference systems, or more mathematically, physical laws have the same form in any system of reference. Whatever system you choose, this must have the same form. This goes under the symmetry of general covariance. Also, a concept which Einstein was, when looking for a theory, was had a very difficult time in finding out the consequence of this principle that of general covariance. I will say a few words in a minute. So this is the generalization of the principle of relativity to arbitrary motions. Then there's another principle which is essential was essential for Einstein, and is an essential symmetry in his theory, namely the symmetry between acceleration and gravitational forces. You see, here for the first time, gravity comes in. I mean, what does motion, acceleration, motion to do with gravity? What is the connection? Here comes the connection. The connection comes, what Einstein says, it was his happiest thought of his life, that was sitting in Bern in his patent bureau, and I think he saw a work on the roof and something fell down, and then he said, well, while the thing is falling, it doesn't feel its weight. And this is sort of the equivalence between acceleration and gravitational forces, and this goes under the name the principle of equivalence. So the principle, what is it? So here's a little picture. It is just makes use of what was known to Galileo already, that all bodies fall with the same acceleration. No matter what its mass is, all bodies fall with the same acceleration. Well, we know that this is not true, because if we observe in autumn when leaves fall from the tree, fall different like the apple, let's say. No? But this is the other cause. Eh? This is because air resistance and so on. But if you, and this was known to Galilei, that if you let fall, always the same thing. If you let fall a box, and you have a ball or whatever particle, and if in the gravitational field, then the box and the thing stay the same, so the box doesn't hit the bottom, but they fall equally with equal acceleration. So it is as if it would be free of any force, and this is the reason why the astronauts are weightless in space. Yeah, in the ISS or what? It is not out of the gravitational attraction of the Earth or the Sun or what? They are weightless because they fall freely. They fall freely, and therefore the astronauts are weightless in the cabin. This is the equivalence principle. The converse of this is this, where the one can, this is what Einstein especially emphasized, if you have this elevator box standing in a gravitational field, then, and you have this particle forced to the bottom, and you can have the same effect if there's no gravitational force, but you accelerate the elevator to the box in the opposite direction with equal acceleration. Effect is the same. And you cannot distinguish this locally. You cannot distinguish this. And this is the equivalence between acceleration and gravitational field. And this was the route to to having this general covariance in a form which relates to gravity. Einstein in 1911 said the exact equivalence of a uniform gravitational field and a uniform acceleration makes it impossible to speak of absolute acceleration of a system of reference. Yeah, just in contrast to the Newtonian thing, where acceleration was felt as inertia, and then one could see without looking outside that the system is accelerated. This, now Einstein says, no, this is not the case. Everything is it could be a gravitational field which causes this inertia effect. And then he says, well, inertia and gravity are phenomena identically in nature. Well, it's not as easy as it's here, because the essential thing is uniform gravitational field. If the field is inhomogeneous, one can, by non-local effects, very well find out whether one is in a gravitational field or just in an accelerated system without gravitational field. But the essence is that locally the gravitational field can be transformed away by going to a freely falling system. This is the key message. Now, I said there are two main symmetry principles involved in relativity. One is the relativity, the generalized principle of relativity, and the so-called equivalence principle, what I've just been talking about. Now, there's a third principle that guided Einstein in his way to his career, which is not exactly a symmetry principle, but can be understood as a kind of asymmetry in the description so far. And this is what is called Marx's principle. It was called by Einstein Marx's principle. Now, Marx's principle, what is it about? Well, as I said, Marx criticized the concept of absolute space of Newton, and there's this famous Newtonian experiment, well, Newton had it with this bucket, the Newton's bucket coil. So there's a bucket with some fluid, let's say water inside, and when you start to rotate it, and slowly the fluid gets into rotation, and that as the fluid gets into rotation, it this so-called centrifugal forces press the fluid to the walls of the bucket, and you get a kind of parabolic shape of the surface. And Newton said, so what is the reason that the fluid, that these centrifugal forces appear? What is the reason for that? Well, for Newton was easy. It is the rotation with respect to absolute space. And this was heavily criticized by Mach, by saying, well, this absolute space, you cannot, where is this absolute space? How is it fixed? How do you know that it is rotating against the absolute space? Yeah? How you find out? And he said, no, it is not the absolute space which causes the fluid to towards the walls of the bucket. It is rather the other stars, the other material, the other masses in the universe which causes this reaction. If there would be no stars in the universe, if there would be no matter in the universe, and you rotate the bucket, nothing will happen. This was the argument by Marx. Of course, this is difficult to check, because how you take away all the masses in the universe and see whether it is right. Well, the point is, since the bucket itself has a certain mass, it must also have an influence on inertia, but also have an inertia. And so, in principle, there should be think about you have no masses, and you start, and the bucket rotates, and then the surface mass should be plain surface, and now you fill in the matter, and then slowly the thing will creep up the walls, but the bucket itself has a certain mass, and therefore there should be some tiny effect leaving the pointing to the mass principle. Well, the question is whether this principle is contained in Einstein's theory. It's a highly debated thing. Yes, there are aspects of Mach principle in general relativity, but not as Einstein would have thought. Not as Einstein would have thought. Actually, it is one of the Austrian physicists, two Austrian actually, Lenz and Thiering, proposed an experiment in 1980 or already to check not with the bucket, but an experiment which goes in this gradient, and was only 10-15 years ago confirmed to a certain accuracy. Well, so this was, so Einstein was highly influenced by this idea. He was really think that this is an essential idea that does away with the asymmetry of having this absolute space which influences the masses, but the masses don't influence the absolute space. So that there is in 1930s that the resistance of inertia is nothing else than the resistance of the body against the relative acceleration with respect to the totality of all other bodies in the universe. Eh? So the question is how to invoke this in how is this really in his theory? I don't have the time to go into the details of what the consequences are, because wanted to talk about symmetry. So at the end of 1950, after a long, long struggle, he finally presented his equation, his final equations of general relativity. I think this is the only formula I have exposed you. And the idea is that gravity is described by geometry. Gravity is described by geometry. Particles don't move under the influence of the gravitational field, but move freely in a so-called non-Euclidean geometry. This is the new formulation of how gravity is described. And there were several tests for this assumption, and all the tests so far passed. The theory is 100 years old and passed all the tests so far. Just a word of this. So this is the object which describes the geometry, not the geometry of space, but the geometry of space-time. As I've told you already in 1905, with special relativity, there was a certain unification of space and time. And now space and time is not a stage which is, so to speak, static, but now the geometry, space and time, becomes dynamic. And the object that describes this is this here, the metric of space-time, and these objects here are built from this in a rather complicated way with derivatives, nonlinear terms, and so on. So this side here is the geometrical part, so describes the geometrical part. And this side here is the this object is called the energy momentum tensor. It is here. This is, so to speak, the source of the gravitational field. The sources of the gravitational field. It contains all matter particles, or even energy, like the energy of if you couple it to the electromagnetic field. The electromagnetic field will be a source of gravity, which manifests itself in a certain geometry of space-time. So this is the famous equation, which is a nice, very elegant-looking equation. Even it looks simple. However, even 100 years after it has put forward, not all the consequences are completely understood. There are severe mathematical problems because it's a non-linear theory with certain speciality, to which I come, I guess, now. Yes, here comes Emmenoether again. As I said, would have Emmenoether published her paper in 1913, Einstein would have probably arrived at the theory already in 1913, let's say. Namely, it has to do with this general covariance. And general covariance, so any system of reference is equally. All the equation of the same form in any system of reference. And this is what I called a local symmetry at the beginning, because this symmetry changes from point to point, And the consequences are different than the one from the global symmetries, which leads straightforward to conservation laws. This is, here it's more subtle. Namely, the general covariance leads to identities. Quite generally, this by Emmenoether, quite generally, starting from a so-called variational principle, say that the two identities among the variables, which then, as a consequence, lead that the system is underdetermined. So that's the solution of the system is not unique, and this was a big problem to Einstein. Not knowing this, that this must be so. Yeah. He was said, why? General covariance, and then found out, but my equations don't allow for unique solution, even talked about causality violations, things like that. Again, if he would have known this, that this must be so, he would have been saved a lot of work. Finally, this underdimension leads to some generalized concepts, to some identities, and to some generalized conservation laws. Maybe I can say that Emmenoether was working with David Hilbert, and I think it was in summer 1915 that Einstein visited Göttingen and actually stayed a week, I think, and lived with, stayed in the house of Hilbert, and was presenting his new ideas on the theory of gravity, and there were still some weak points, and Hilbert spotted that these weak points, and since starting from a variational principle, he automatically got a generally covariant equation, and well, as history is, I think 7 days before Einstein filed in his paper at the Preußische Akademie, Hilbert filed in a paper at the Göttinger Akademie, which contained equations that Einstein's paper, and Einstein knew about this paper because Hilbert sent it. So the things go. Maybe I'm not an historian of science, maybe in the audience one. The paper of Hilbert is very difficult to read. But from my knowledge, it is quite clear that Einstein did not copy the equation from Hilbert. Because Einstein had a completely different approach, he had a physical approach to this. And then there were some hardships between Hilbert and Einstein, but finally Hilbert said, no, Mr. Einstein, that's completely your theory, I don't think. And now we call the action that leads to Einstein's equation the Hilbert or the Hilbert-Einstein action, but the equations are called Einstein's equations. So Yes. So this is the other imminent input from Emmanuel, realizing that this is a very general feature of if one has these local symmetries, that their identities and systems are then not completely determined. It needs, so to speak, gauge condition, what we call it in modern particle physics, let's say. So Einstein on his theory says, well, in Newton's theories, one had the opinion that if matter would disappear, space and time alone would remain as a kind of stage of all physical events. Here's the German translation, because this is my translation, too. Maybe it might not be literally correct. So this was, you see, this is the outcome of the idea of Mach's principle, that if there's no matter, there shouldn't be any space. Yeah, there shouldn't be any space. So matter and space are tied together. No matter, no energy, no space there. Of course, this is not, turned out not to be correct, and Einstein modified his equation to achieve this, but it was wrong, and finally, so this is not achieved in his theory. Here again the same thing, that it is impossible to ascribe space and time as separate physical reality, independent of the real objects. Well, they are so-called vacuum solutions of the Einstein equation, yeah, without any matter or energy. So let me, so much for the way to the ideas that guided Einstein in setting up his theory, and are still the principles, so to speak, the principles that are inherent in his theory. Now, since this is a conference on symmetry, let me, in the remaining time, say a few words about special symmetries in his theory. Namely, one has this general covariance, of course, but there may be solutions which have a special symmetry. Actually, these are the important ones, because the other ones cannot be found. The point is that in order to simplify the equations, one makes the assumption that space-time should have certain symmetries. Yeah? And then one can try to solve this difficult equation. And there are very prominent solutions which would have a high symmetry. Now, this is in cosmological models, in black hole physics, and in gravitational waves. Just let me say a few words of the first two, because of gravitational waves, there will be another talk. So cosmology, the assumption is that on the large scale, space is homogeneous and isotropic. I have explained what homogeneous and isotropic means, so translational invariance and rotational invariance, these so-called global symmetries. If one imposes these symmetries on space, then the result is that the spaces, one obtains the spaces of constant curvature. I understand there will be talks on non-Euclidean geometry as a contribution, so maybe I can only be very, very schematic here. Well, here's an example of two-dimensional surfaces embedded in a three-dimensional fictitious space, which have constant curvature. Well, the most simple one is this one, which is just a flat piece of paper, sheet thing, and then there's this so-called hyperbolic space. Every point has the same curvature, and I would say about what how curvature is measured, and then there is this positive curvature space. It is not the embedding, how the surface is embedded in three-dimensional space, because if I take this sheet, for example, and make a cylinder, it is still flat. Internally, it is still flat. So it's not the external curvature, the embedding, it's the internal curvature. And this can be seen, or measured, or inferred, by drawing a triangle and measuring the angles, the sum of the angles we learn in school in Euclidean geometry makes 180 degrees. If you have a curved surface, this may deviate, will deviate. But if I make a cylinder out of the sheet, the angles stay the same. I don't tear it and so. But if I do this on the sphere, the sum will be greater than 180 degrees. So this is then, of course, this is just two-dimensional. Now we're speaking about three or four-dimensional curved space. So space, respectively, space-time. So cosmological models are based on spaces of constant curvature. And if one allow, the assumption, this is just a picture showing you that the universe is not homogeneous. Of course not, yeah? So what we see here, we look out from here and look out into space, and all the dots you see are galaxies. And clusters of galaxies. Okay. So it's not uniformly distributed, but the idea is on the large scale, if we average over large scale, then it's homogeneous. And this goes into the assumption for the cosmological models. And astonishing, the work quite extremely well, actually. Now, already in 1922 and 24, Alexander Friedman published two papers on cosmologies with exactly what I've said, with spaces, assuming that the space is homogeneous and isotropic, and found solutions where the spaces are of constant curvature. That means in space the curvature is everywhere, but it's not constant in time. So the curvature changes from time to time, and this is what you see here. So time is here, runs from here to here, and this is, well, let's say the radius of the universe, it's not so clear. This is a typical distance in the universe between, say, clusters of galaxies or so. And what one sees is that all these models in this direction as time goes on expand. Yeah? All they expand, some of them recollapse, and others expand forever. But all of them together is something that, when going backwards in time, that it comes to where the distances become smaller and smaller and smaller, and finally end up in what is called a singularity. It's there the equation, Einstein's equations break down, yeah, because everything goes beyond bound, because it's called a singularity. And this singularity now we call the Big Bang. Not knowing exactly what the Big Bang actually was, but we know what afterwards happened. Now, amazingly, this was largely ignored at the time. Only at the end of the 20s, it was realized that these are the models which could fit the observational data, and the observational data was achieved by Edwin Hubble, who found out that the galaxies have a shift in the spectrum, which was interpreted as a velocity, and it was shown that all the galaxies recede from us. All galaxies recede from us, and this was then later called expansion of the universe. So we sit here in our galaxy, look out, and actually, the expansion velocity is proportional to the distance. This is Hubble's famous law, and was as the expansion of the universe. And this is exactly what the Friedman models tell us. This continuous expansion. This seemed to contradict. This picture seemed to contradict the homogeneity assumption. But if you think a little bit, it's not. If you look using this law, and you find yourself on a different galaxy and look out, that exactly the same picture will emerge. So it's from every part, it's every equal. So everything recedes from everything. So there's no center. There's no center in this model. Now, a confirmation of our cosmology, cosmological models, especially the Big Bang cosmology, is the code, what is the microwave background, and gives us information how the universe was in an early stage, say 400,000, 380,000 years after what I called the Big Bang, and it was highly homogeneous, with little differences. What you see here, I don't have time to explain everything in detail, but this is an electromagnetic radiation which has a certain temperature, and the temperature is highly equal in every point in the sky. And the different colors are the difference in the temperature, which the difference are a 10,000th of a degree Celsius. So the temperature is highly uniform. Nevertheless, it is very important to have these differences, because these differences are then, in the later development of the universe, the seeds of condensation of matter and formation of the structures we see in the universe. And a picture that is often shown is this one. This is our picture, understanding of the evolution of the universe. It starts with something which is called quantum fluctuation, but never mind. You see, well, one doesn't see exactly what it is. But here is the cosmic microwave background of which I've been talking, and from there on the universe, so to speak, it cools down, and matter condensate into the structure, and we hold now about 13.7, roughly 14 billion years after the Big Bang. Well, so much for this very. I should say that modern cosmology has severe problems. I will not go into this problem, just mention dark matter and dark energy, but nevertheless, the data where we can reproduce the observational data with these models to an astonishing degree of accuracy. Of course, there are these open problems, but any new idea would have to cope with that, what we can already explain. Let me use my last 5 minutes to talk about black holes, because black holes are very special solutions of Einstein's equations and are important, as we think we know that black holes are rather abundant in the universe, especially in the nucleus of galaxies. We think that there are black holes with millions of solar masses. So the understanding of these objects, which is an outcome of general relativity, is essential. And one of the simplest solutions, which was very early discovered, is the solution which is spherically symmetric. If one assumes spherical symmetry for the space-time, for space-time, then automatically the vacuum equation, if I'm going to describe the geometry outside of a body, a spherical symmetric body, is static. So here's a picture again of a two-dimensional surface embedded in a fictitious three-dimensional space, which is just with the geometry when you cut through a star at an equatorial plane, let's say, then the outside geometry looks something like this. This is the interior of the star, and one of the outcomes is that one has the so-called light bending in the gravitational field, that the light rays are deflected when passing near an object in this geometry. Actually, a tool that is highly used in understanding the object in our universe nowadays. In the early days, this just was one of the key observation to support general relativity. Now, if this object collapses, that somehow under its own gravitational waves, then this shrinks, the star shrinks, and leaving behind a vacuum solution. The singularity forms and leaves behind a vacuum solution, and this is what is called a black hole. Now, here I would like to explain you briefly how to understand this. Look at the right-hand side. This is here in the these points are flashes, short flashes, which send out electromagnetic radiation, a torchlight, short flash of a torchlight, and it moves out on a sphere, here two-dimensional on a circle. So it propagates at an instant afterwards like this. But if one is close to a black hole, then the light rays, so to speak, are attracted to this black hole. And yes, thank you. Attracted. And the closer one comes, always the same thing. The closer one comes, the more the flashlight travels, the burst travels in the direction of the black hole, until one reaches something where what is called the horizon, where even the radially outgoing direction doesn't go out, but stays, so to speak, at a constant distance. And further in, all the light rays in all directions bend, so to speak, towards this central singularity, what is called central singularity. Here again is this now this picture of the black hole. This is the horizon where these flashes all abound inside this circle or sphere, I think, and nothing can come out from here. That's why it's called a black hole, even not light. It's all trapped within this region of space. Here's a space-time. Here's a space-time picture of the same thing. Now this is more difficult to read. Time runs upwards. Space in two-dimensional is here. This is the surface. This is the surface and the interior of a star that collapses in two dimensions. One spatial dimension is missing, and this is the surface how it collapses, becomes smaller and smaller. And what you see here are these little so-called little light cones. These are these flashes, yeah? Flashes in space-time. So one has a flash here, and then light rays run in all directions and form a little cone. In afterwards. And as you see, as the star collapses and the light cones come closer and closer to the mass, the light cones start to tip over. The light can tip over until they reach the point where even the outgoing direction, this is called the outgoing direction, the light rays are trapped in the sense that they move along the so-called horizon, and further in, or everything ends up in this thing. So these are the geometry of these objects, of which we believe there are many, many, many in the in the universe, and as you will hear, these black holes are involved in the generation and the detection of gravitational waves. These are the essential that we have observed, detected gravitational waves. We believe that the signal comes from two colliding black holes. I guess I stop here, and maybe there are some comments or questions. Let me just, there's some symmetries. I don't show you this. There's some symmetries, of course, maybe I show you this. There are some symmetries involved in the gravitational waves. They are so-called plane waves. They are, of course, the simplest solutions are plane waves, which are very high symmetry, and here is how they act on a ring of freely particles when a gravitational wave passes through them, and the geometry is deformed. Yes. This is a little cartoon. Is that a crack in Einstein's theory of relativity? Nothing is perfect. Well, thank you very much.
Technical problem.
Nobody's perfect.
Thank you. So is there a microphone?
Who has stolen the microphone? Here it is.
Thank you.
I have to switch
off. So we're going to...
Just a moment.
Switch off?
Yeah.
So the way it works is I have to switch this on. He has to switch his off, and then I switch mine off. He switches his on. So I'm going to ask for questions.
And I have to pass the microphone down. Normally, I would stand there and hold up the microphone with an iron grip so someone doesn't talk too long. So if you could just keep your questions or comments brief, that would help so other people get it. So I'll pass the microphone, and then could you pass the microphone back to me?
So my question is it serious that in the deep of Eridan emptiness, there are some point of a locally smaller temperature, and perhaps it is from this point starts Big Bang. I read some places. So probably Big Bang started from the point which in the center of Eridan emptiness, because there are locally smaller temperature. Is it serious or it is just a junk?
My answer is I don't know. I'm not aware of this. Modern cosmologists say, well, there's the vacuum, and in quantum physics, the vacuum, of course, is not empty. There are fluctuations, you know, from quantum theory, that there are always fluctuations, even if you are in the ground state. There are fluctuations about this ground state, and the universe might have emerged from such a quantum fluctuations. This leads to the picture of multiverses, but these fluctuations happen all the time and all everywhere. So there are many, many universes around us. We just don't know them. This is some people propagate. As long as we don't have a well-established theory of quantum gravity, I'm rather skeptical. And also, I think that that if you need infinite many universes to explain just one universe, I think that is not very. I turn off.
Okay, next.
Hello? Okay, good.
Yes, you illustrated constant negative curvature by showing a hyperbolic paraboloid. But the hyperbolic paraboloid doesn't have constant negative curvature. A pseudosphere has. So I was surprised that you used this example.
It is a part of a negative space of constant curvature.
Well, if you would have used a pseudosphere, then you could have a total object with a constant negative curvature. I'm only surprised why in this talks they use a sphere for positive constant negative curvature. For positive curvature, but never a pseudosphere for constant negative.
Yeah, but how you depict that? How do you speak?
It's the right picture, actually.
What?
This
actually is the picture. The Poincaré thing. This is the right negative. Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay. Next. Here. Could you pass this down?
In the Friedmann solutions, you showed the omega point. Could you please expand a bit on the physics of the omega point?
Well, as I say, turn it off. What's that mean? It is called a singularity because all the quantities grow without bound, without limit. Yeah. So it's not a solution. This limiting point is not a solution of Einstein's equation. It's not a solution. So it's overstretching. It's overstretching the validity of Einstein's equation and must be replaced at some stage by a theory which goes beyond this, and we think that this can only be done in a by uniting quantum theory with gravity. But at the moment, so this is the classical picture. There are, as I said, there are some in string theory, in loop quantum gravity, there are certain theories which overcome this kind of singularity and as a solution of the new theory. But these are by far not finished. All these theories have problems, and the main problem is it cannot be tested. It will not be tested so easily. That's the point. We don't have a guiding experiment observation which shows us the way, the right way. What theoreticians do is they work on consistency. That's the guiding line, consistency, that the theory is consistent. Of course, with the hope that someday we might be able to test it, but at the moment this is not the case.
Thank you. Do we have just a
brief question, because we're going a little into the break.
Actually, a related question. I was curious about Friedman's work. Am I understanding correctly that he was extrapolating those models of the radius of the universe solely from the general relativistic sort of equations and not from any experimental data, and the experimental data came after?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I said already yes. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, it's astonishing. You know, there was another solution which was a problem to Einstein, as I mentioned, the solution of the theta, which is also a cosmological solution which contains the so-called cosmological constant. Einstein modified his equation because he thought the equation should not have vacuum solutions. Yeah? And then he adds this cosmological constant in the hope that there are no vacuum solutions with the cosmological constant. But then the theta published a solution without matter with the cosmological constant. And this universe, where there was a big debate, and the particle in this universe should also show a redshift. And then it was interpreted as partly as a velocity redshift, partly as a gravitational redshift. So the theta solution was much more discussed in those days than the Friedman solution. So we quit.
So
let's please thank Professor Eichelberg. Thank you very much. Excellent beginning for the Einstein Centennial Lectures. And now I'd like to point out we have a break until 11:30, and there's some refreshments outside. And for those people who want to use the Wi-Fi here, you at the registration desk, I'm told, you can get your passcode. Okay, so we'll reconvene at 11:30 here. Thank you.